Hello,
I'm alive. Kind of. Say 80s and all sorts of stuff on there.
Hiya!
Full. Yes, I did catch it. Hello everybody. Right, I'm back. A little bit of a different video to normal, as you can probably tell. And I've got my camera at a weird angle that I'm not used to having. But, as you can probably see from all these bits here, I've been asked by literally a few people for a full breakdown and reassembly video of VSR10. The MB03. So, as you can see, there are lots and lots of pieces. This is actually Matt's, or Spectre's, MB03, which he left with me for some minor upgrades, the spring being one of them, and just to reduce air seals throughout. And I'm wearing rubber gloves, as you can probably see, because once I have done this, he will be respraying it more of a camo rather than the black. So, without further ado, as you can probably see, I have the bolt assembly in pieces here. Now, with the air nozzle here, you'll see, I'll take a picture and get a close-up shot, but in the end of here, there are some threads. Now, from the factory, sometimes, depending on where you get it from, and depending on where the suppliers got their supply from, there is a little, like a grub screw, really, in the end of there, which is an FPS reducer. So out of the box, these from where we got them from, without the reducer in, they fire at about 415 FPS stock. With the reducer in, they fire at about 300 FPS stock. They were actually meant more for the Asian market. So all you need to do is basically follow the steps that I'm going to be doing, but in reverse, so you can whip it out. Now, on the threads of this, you'll probably see that little white, or it's more grey now, which is just to improve grip on the threads and to stop the nozzle from unscrewing, is some of this stuff, which is plumber's tape or PTFE tape. Dirt cheap to buy, really easy to use. I stick it round the threads and quite often just after the hop rubber on an ear and a barrel. It just improves the air seal and the fit of things. So, in reverse, oh yes, this is what Spectre's had done this time round. This is a M150 VSR spring. Now, those of you who don't really deal with sniper rifles, or as the first time dealing with sniper rifles, you may be looking at that going, that's a bit of a small spring. That's your normal AEG spring. This is actually out of ICS Ape, I think. It is actually, yes. and they're about 12 or 14 millimeters across the coils, whereas a VSR spring is about 10. But as you can probably notice, I'll do a close, again, there'll be pictures of close-up comparison between these. The actual coils themselves are much, much thicker gauge because obviously it's a sniper spring. Because again, Matt's VSR out of the box was firing at a fairly respectable 425 FPS. That was after we put in an upgraded barrel. This is not the stock barrel. The stock barrel is a brass 6.04 millimeter inner barrel. So it's been upgraded to a 6.02 aluminium barrel. Which obviously improves the FPS and everything anyway. So it was firing at 425 with that barrel. So, new spring. There will be some chrono readings because I have chronoed this, but I didn't film it. So there'll be some chrono readings to follow some of this, and you'll see what it fires at on full hop and then the hop set correctly. So I was talking about that, talking away and just doing it anyway. Right, spring guide in the back end of the spring, ideally the most open end of the spring, as you can see. There's several ways you can do this, but I usually put the piston then on top of the spring, turn the whole lot upside down, grab the cylinder and feed it all straight in. Again, like I say, 90% of this rifle is stock. The only upgrades is the barrel, the spring, and you'll see that little green O-ring on the piston head. That is just because the O-ring that was on it at the factory stock isn't particularly good. But it's good enough, but if you get a chance, just upgrade it. Now, you will have seen on some of the Airsoft YouTube celebrities that there's a special tool for doing the nozzle on an Airsoft sniper rifle. Yeah, a pair of needle nose pliers. See the two little holes in the top of the nozzle? Needle nose in there, like so, and turn to clockwise, which then nibs it up nice and tight. So that is dropped. So that is the cylinder assembled. One of the easiest bits. Now, I can take my gloves off now because that's the oiliest bit dealt with. Chuck them out of the way. Don't know if I've said this before, but I will put a list of tools required for assembly and disassembly of a VSR. Right. Outer barrel. Nice, simple piece of aluminium. And I'm just going to clear up that hill there. Better. Right. And I've got the hop assembly and the barrel here. You can see the hop assembly because it slides in and out. Yeah, yucky. Right. So you want the inner barrel and outer barrel obviously to line up. Now, you may find some resistance because there is a barrel spacer. The barrel spacer in these is about midpoint. As you can see, I've got this inside it now, so the barrel doesn't move too much. Now, which way up or right? When putting the hop unit in, you'll see there is a large sort of hole there. That's where your BBs go in. So you need to make sure that lines up with that hole there. So it's just a simple point of twisting it so it's right. And it'll push most of the way in fairly easily with your finger. If you've only got short fingers, you might want something like the butt end of a thin screwdriver, which I haven't got with me anyway, but I've got it most of the way. And then you just want to, on the top of the hop unit, I'll bring that up close again. You may see there's a screw hole there and a screw hole there. This screw hole has to line up with that hole in the barrel there. Otherwise you can't get it all to fit together and step. So that is lined up there. Whilst I've got it apart, you see the hop arm, if I hold it this end, you'll probably see it properly. The hop arm with a screw in it, maybe a screwdriver, that goes, out of those two, as you look at it, it will be the right hand screw hole in the plastic hop arm section there. You just want to screw that back in. Obviously I unscrewed it because otherwise you can't get the hop chamber out. So screw that back in. Now obviously because it is plastic, you don't want to screw it in too tight because you could knack the threads. So you just want to screw it just tight enough so it holds in place. There you go. And then you'll be able to adjust it from the outside of the gun again. Next to assemble is this bit here. This is partly what the barrel fits to, and you'll notice this spring here, that is part of the mag release. So you see there's a hole in the back of it. Actually, I'll take the spring out because I'll need that in a minute. Remember the two holes on the hop unit? Yep. There's a hole there, and there's a hole here, which I've both got screws in them. They line up with the two previously shown screw holes, and that actually holds the hop unit solid in place. Now these you can tighten up properly because they are metal screws going into metal threads. Obviously you don't want to do them too tight because you may round off the heads, and then if you round off the heads, you're going to have all manner of trouble getting the hop unit back out, because you'd have to drill them out and then you're going to have issues. Right. So that is now screwed in. Last bit on the actual main part of the barrel itself is the barrel cap, which as you can see is quite deep. The end of the inner barrel does actually sit inside this, so in fact actually I'm going to put a bit of PTF tape on that as well, because I know that Matt won't be taking this off a huge amount, because I'm the one who tends to work on it for him. Right. Again, with PTFE tape, if you're going to put it on, you just want it to sit on the actual threads of whatever you're putting it on. And you don't want too much sticking out anywhere. So once it's on, just make sure it's all nice and clean and tidy and smoothed out of the way, because this stuff actually, you'll see, it sits nicely in the threads there and sits nice and tight. Now, like I say, again, this is just to make sure it doesn't unscrew when you don't want it unscrewing. You'll still be able to undo it perfectly fine. It's a bit like removable thread lock. Again, but with the screw-on cap, there is no special way of doing it. It's literally just tighten it up with your hand and then it's done. Then that is your outer barrel, pretty much fully assembled. You've then got this section. Let me put this down so you'll see. This section, which is where the bolt sits. Obviously, you'll see there's no barrel in it. The back end of the barrel is threaded, and you should see there is a hole in the top, and you'll see the line on the back. That is because in this upper section here, I need a little Allen key, there is an Allen key screw right at the rear of the rail, and there is a Phillips screw, or a cross blade screw, on the underside of this upper receiver, basically. So you need to make sure both of those are out, line up the barrel and the threads, obviously screw it in until it's all the way in. This does take a second or two. And that, bring it back a bit. The hop area is supposed to be on the bottom. Obviously the rails are supposed to be on the top. And then you have to just make sure that hole in the bottom of the outer barrel is lined up with the hole on the main receiver part. That is where the Phillips screw, cross blade screw, goes. You just screw that back in. All the way. Now again, with this screw, you don't want to screw it, tighten it too tight, because it could protrude through the outer barrel and hamper pushing the bolt in. Obviously that's bad, because then every time you cycle the bolt, you're going to be scratching the outside of the bolt. The Allen key bolt again goes back through the hole in the rails segment, and it just stops the barrel from moving that little bit more. That's nice and tight. So that is your barrel, upper receiver, all nice and tight again, no movement. Now you will have noticed, or may have noticed, that I didn't put the spring back in there just yet. That spring is what helps you release your magazine, and it just sits on top of the screw that goes in there. Now, sometimes these fit loosely, that's why I didn't put it in, but luckily Matt's is nice and tight, so it sits there quite nicely. Oh, my foot's gone numb. Right, next bit, where we start making it able to go bang. The bolt, as you can see, there's a nice big hole in the back. Nozzle end in first, with the slot on the bolt pointing down. Slides. Ouch, all the way in. You want to locate it all the way in, and then you need to, you'll see there's a little sort of access hole here. You need to turn the bolt handle down until the slot in the bottom of the cylinder lines up nicely, just there. You see? I'll, again, like I say, I'll do some nice close-up pictures so you can see these properly. Oh, next bit, oh, I'm going to move. Next bit to assemble is the trigger block. Again, I've not bothered taking the trigger mech to pieces because it doesn't need it, but that is your trigger mechanism with sear, sear, and a separate sear. Now the separate sear pushes up through this hole here, and that will lock everything in place. So you'll see,
ugh, greasy.
You see on the bottom of the upper receiver there is a little hole just there, and there is a little hole towards the rear just there. Funnily enough, on the trigger block there is a hole at the front and there is a hole at the back. These, now some people find it easy to have this sear taken out when you reassemble it. I find it easier because once you drop it in place, it's sat there and it's nice and held tight. It's not going to fall off while you're trying to screw it in. So you've got a couple of dinky little screws and washers. These, and the holes I showed you earlier, funnily enough, they screw into those. Now, in the stock trigger box, the stock trigger box is plastic, and obviously the receiver is metal, so you don't want to screw these down too tight. Tight enough so, you know, you can feel the resistance, but not so tight that you crack the plastic. Otherwise, a standard replacement box is about £50, whereas, no, so it's not, it's about £30 or £40, whereas an upgrade box is about £110. So yeah. Next piece of assembly is the trigger guard. Now in the front of this trigger guard you'll see there is a little cutout here that actually slots round. Oh, I can get it facing the right way. That is like a T-shaped notch that sticks up. So you put the trigger through the hole in the back, in the slot, can't even point, this slot here, and that cutout lines up with a sort of H piece there, and then there's a screw at the back on a long post that just screws into the back of the receiver. When it's lined up, there we go, it's lined up, and again it's plastic, you don't want to tighten it too tight. So that is your upper receiver bolt trigger assembly all fully built. See? Safety, whoops, safety works and everything. See? And take safety off and it fires again. So that is the majority of the assembly actually complete. The only part left to do is drop the upper receiver on the lower receiver, or the stock, whatever you want to call it. Now I tend to find this easier to line the rear up first, because it drops into a slot at the back, and then the hop unit area does slide in like so. That is essentially fully assembled. When you move that out of the way, when you do disassemble one of these, you'll notice you have two different sized Allen bolts. You've got a long Allen bolt and a short Allen bolt. The long Allen bolt goes to the rear and the short Allen bolt goes to the front. You'll see on the bottom of the stock, obviously I'll just put a screw in one of them, but there is a hole there and there is a hole there. That's where these Allen bolts go. Now this is a, it's a 4mm, yes, it's a 4mm Allen wrench or Allen key, depending on what part of the world you're from, for reassembling the upper and lower receiver together. I mean, most, or a lot of, airsoft sniper rifles disassemble the same way. Again, you don't want to do this too tight, but just tight enough so, again, you feel the resistance and you can tell it's actually tight. Now, it's fairly easy to tell why the shorter screw goes to the front and the longer screw goes to the rear, because the stock is tapered that way. It's wider here than it is here. Just makes sense, really, doesn't it? And I've got one more item to actually put on this for him, which is his scope, just to finish the picture, really. He's already had the scope on it, and we know it works. It just needs zero in him, and wants to put him back on it, because we're taking it out with us Sunday, when we next play. So, let's just do that up. Now, oddly, the smaller Allen key bolt seems like it takes a lot longer. Now, I know this is empty, but I'm just going to slot it in just so it doesn't get any gump in there. And come back out again. This is the scope that Spectre's got, which is just a new Prol 4x32, and it's illuminated scope. So he's got the, I'm not sure how well you're going to see this. He's not even got any batteries in it, so there's no point. So you've got red or green reticle on this. So depending on what takes your fancy. So just slot that back on the top rail. See, scopes are fairly simple to put on. You just put them on the location that you want them going. I'll go forward a bit because I know he likes his forwards a bit. And then doing them up. Now these do come with a washer and the little nut. You don't have to have them. Well, again, like I say, a lot of scopes are different. Some do come with a little nut, some don't come with a little nut. It's, again, it's just whatever ones you buy. But the 4x32 or a 40mm aperture is more than enough for airsoft. The second measurement, so 4x32, 4x40, 4x50, whatever, is the aperture of the actual scope. It's 32mm across, which is more than enough for airsoft, because it just needs to be accurate enough. And 4x zoom, again, is more than enough for airsoft, because, again, you're not really going to be shooting massive long distances. So, that is the reassembly of an MB03. If you want to watch the disassembly, just watch this in reverse, because it's exactly the same. But I thought the assembly itself would probably be more beneficial, because if anyone's taken one to pieces and not sure how to put it back together again, you can follow this, providing it was all in focus, and it should be fairly easy to follow. Now, there will be another video coming up. I'll stick down here so you can see me. Hello. There will be another video coming up, which is, I'm calling it the ARM-92, because it's an amalgamation of an ARX-160 and a Beretta M92. I've basically made, effectively, a Ronin kit for a Beretta. But it's more of a pistol caliber DMR. And I know that's kind of hypocritical of me, because I'm not a fan of DMRs, but I don't want to downgrade the pistol that I've used for it, and I had this body laying around. So it's going to be fun when I'm running around with my M15 and someone's a little bit out of range. I can hit them with a pistol at that range. So, if there's anything else you want to see, bang them in the comments below. There is links to, oh yes, before I forget, in the coming weeks, next probably, hopefully, couple of weeks, when I hit 250 subscribers, I will be doing a giveaway. You'll have to follow the link in the description to my Facebook page to go through the rules and actually enter the giveaway competition. It is just going to be basically pick a number between, you know, 1 and 250. But it's just so I can track the names, and then I'll do a semi-live draw for who wins. I'm not telling you what the prize is going to be yet, because I've sort of picked it, but I've not. So that should be fun. But yes, when I hit 250, there'll be a giveaway. Just as a thank you to all of you who have subscribed. Like I say, hopefully it won't be too long, because I'm at about 232-ish at the moment. I've not checked in a couple of days. But yes, if there's anything else you want to see, bang it in the comments below. If you are around the Mansfield, Nottinghamshire area this coming Sunday, which is the 20th, and can get over to Skirmish at Budby, myself and Matt Spectre and maybe one or two other of the Thin Brown line will be there. Not all of us can make it this time, so Cage Bat and Tank Girl unfortunately won't be there, I don't think, because Cage Bat pulled his knee and they are touring Scotland at the moment. I don't know if they're back yet. Alan, or Psycho Squirrel, or Badger, if you want to call him, is up north, so he won't be there. The Man of Glass, or Chris, he won't be there because he's down south. Bonza, again, unfortunately has to work, because him getting time off at the weekend is quite difficult. But I will be there, Spectre will be there, quite possibly Dom will be there, who's a Thin Brown Line member and one of the site marshals. Potentially Tony and Ben might be there. They are again Skirmish, well, I'm not sure if they're both Skirmish employees now, but they are both honorary members of Thin Brown Line, so they may well be there. But we're there from 8:30 till about 4:30 on this coming Sunday. So if you want to jump down and play alongside us and get to see some of my crazy builds firsthand, we will be there. So for now, thanks for watching.